everybody. I am back home and had some great questions come in while I was away, and figured I'd jump right in and do our next Q&A. Our friend Mick wrote in. He says, "Hey Cliff, I've got a good question for you. How do you keep your repertoire and playing style varied enough that it doesn't all sound the same? Do you have any tips for making very similar songs sound more distinct and interesting for listeners? All the best, Mick." Well, Mick, you know, I sometimes worry that it does all sound the same, you know, and that's a challenge. That seems to me like one of the things that I struggle against on a daily basis, right? I'm a banjo player who plays a 5-string banjo, you know, and that can all sound pretty much all the same if you approach the instrument with one playing style. Or if you only have one instrument, you know, I usually keep 2 or 3 banjos around me. Each one will be a distinct instrument. You know, like this one is my 1888 Luscombe. It's got a skin head and I keep nylon or gut strings on it. The other banjo I usually play is a Wayman from about 1910. It also has a skin head but steel strings on it. So these two instruments sound very distinct. So that's one way you can make it all not sound the same is even if you only play one style, if you've got two instruments, have fun with it. Set up your other instrument totally different from your main one or whatever. Have a fretless one and a fretted one, something like that. So that gives you more variety. The other way you know to vary up your playing style, well, you're going to have to learn more than just one approach to the banjo. You know, don't just learn. Clawhammer, overhand style. Besides learning overhand, learn 2-finger picking. It's a pretty simple transition. I even recommend to a lot of people who are starting out to even start out 2-finger picking. I happen to think that that's an easier, more intuitive way to start learning. So that's an easy way to pick up some variety. Pick up some 2-finger picking besides your stroke style. Yeah, I mean, that can really change that. The other way is if you know a song sounds good in like a waltz timing. You know, play that song as a waltz style song. I know, for example, Rose Conley, the Willow Garden song. A lot of the bluegrassers play that in a typical 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3-4 timing. But you can make it sound different and I think a little more old-fashioned if you do it in a waltz time, 1-2-3 down in the willow garden, as opposed to the more down in the willow garden, da-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee-dee, you know. So there's different ways like that you can get more variety. Really, a lot of your variety and the your own unique flavored style of playing is going to come with time. You know, you're going to spend a lot of hours playing, and you'll come up with variations and stuff that you like, and you know, make it your own, right? And that's what I'm really interested in encouraging people to do that, to make each of these songs their own, and also make these styles your own. Don't just try to copy, word for word, some 2 or 3-finger picking style out of a book or something, or off of a film or something like that, or even a person you know. It's okay to copy people to begin with, right? But you know, the idea is that we want to keep going keep this tradition living and breathing through us, so that we are, you know, make the style your own. Don't just copy other people. Take what's best of all the different, you know, stylistic little flares that you see. Take the best of all that stuff you see and try to come up with something that's your own. Like, I'm getting to the point now, I've been playing for almost 20 years, and I'm getting to the point now where I have to stop myself from drifting back and forth between different picking styles just in one song that I'm playing. And it's really hard for me to try to define what style I might be playing. I mean, sometimes I make music on this thing and it's just not any particular style of playing the banjo at all. It's just I'm doing some weird thing to accompany song usually. So yeah. Another thing I think we all should do more of is some footwork while you're playing. Tap your foot, stomp your foot. Don't be afraid to do that. Some of the best banjo performances I've seen And I remember that great charged feeling when I watched the performer play. That person was stomping their foot or both feet. And that's a really cool added percussive effect. I mean, remember, you know, in the early days, traditionally back in Africa in the early colonial days, this instrument was almost always accompanied by drums and dance, and or the juba hand bone padding. There's always a percussive accompaniment to the song. And there's lots of early accounts of those early African-American banjo players working their feet pretty fast. And you see that too with a lot of the fiddle players up north in Canada, the native and the white fiddle players. They do a lot of fancy footwork while they're fiddling. Both feet are usually rattling off. I think that's cool. So that's one, you know, there's all kinds of ways you can get variety. You know, I spent a lot of time on this one question, but, you know, holler back at me, Mick. Tell me what you think about that response. Let's keep talking about it. It's a fascinating subject. And I want to get on to another question here. So Justin wrote in, and he says, I'm wondering if you can talk a little about the role improvisation played in old-time music. Do the old-timers tend to just improvise within songs that people were playing, giving the known songs their own touch? Or was there a lot of jamming going on where music was made up on the spot? Well, Justin, that's a tough question, of course. It's both. I think, you know, the improvisation on the spot, especially in a group, I think traditionally, historically, that would be more associated with African-American music. That stuff is more known in the literature I've read and recordings I've heard. There's more on-the-spot improvisation traditionally in the African traditions, but certainly it was also present in the Anglo-Scots-Irish traditions too. But it seems to me mostly like, you know, white banjo pickers and stuff back in the day tended to be maybe a little bit more regulated, and like you say, improvising within boundaries more. Whereas if you listen to a lot of those old, like listen to Dink Roberts, for example, there's a guy who I don't think he ever played anything twice, the same two times in a row, you know. That guy is all pretty much sounds like he's always improvising. Check out Dink Roberts. He's a great North Carolina or Virginia black banjo player. I believe he died in the 80s. He's really something else for improvising on the spot. But Justin, the short answer for that is that it's both. But probably mostly the former. People are mostly improvising within the songs because that just makes it easier to play with other people, and it keeps the song recognizable, you know. But it's both. Let's see if I can do one more question here, guys, before this video gets to be too big. Kevin asks, he says, I am by far most comfortable with traditional folk music, Appalachian, Irish, Scottish, etc. That's what I like. However, I don't like to limit my horizons. The problem I have is that whenever a tune crops up out of my comfort zone, particularly those containing a strange key change or something, I find myself reaching for the guitar, which feels a bit like a cop-out. I guess Kevin's more comfortable playing the guitar. He's a guitar player originally. I play pretty much solely clawhammer and find that if a song slips out of the usual run of chords for a key, the drone string becomes a real pain, but I can't play without hitting it. Any suggestions? Do I need to learn some closed shapes past the fifth fret? Learn some new techniques? Or stop worrying and play the banjo when it's appropriate and when it isn't? Okay, Kevin, well, I think I even gave you the short answer to this in writing already, and the short answer is stop worrying about it, and just if you feel like reaching for the guitar, hell, play the guitar. But if you really want to focus on your banjo playing, it wouldn't hurt to learn some neat, you know, shapes up here. I don't really know that many shapes up here personally, so I would say that it's not vital. But that wouldn't hurt. That's going to improve, you know, it's going to improve your as a banjo player if you learn some of these shapes and use them. There's a lot of fun up here. There's a lot of great music up here. So I wouldn't discourage you from learning that at all by any means. I'm sort of having trouble figuring out exactly what your problem is. It sounds subtle. But yeah, like when you get out of your comfort zone, well, I mean, if you really want to focus on the banjo, then just like don't touch that guitar for like a month, and only play the banjo. Like that's, I know when I first got this guitar back here when I was in college a few years ago, and I didn't know how to play it, and I wanted to force myself to learn it, so I would do things like put the banjos in the case and only have the guitar laying around, so I could only play the guitar. I've found that when I've really immersed myself in something like that, or been really harsh with myself and forced myself away from something, that that's when you can sometimes force a breakthrough that way. So maybe do that, like put your guitar in the case and put it up and only have your banjo and learn those shapes up here. Why not? That would be cool. I should do the same. Well, guys, this video is getting to be about a 12-minute video, about where I like to keep them. It's been a pleasure as always. Thanks for watching. Thanks everybody for sending in your questions. And I hope you liked that last video I put up of in South Carolina with that nice pretty sunset behind me that my family shot. Nice little special video. It was good to see everybody. But I'm back, and I'm back in the swing of things. I'm going to get back into making banjos and doing these videos as usual. So thanks for watching, guys. Thanks for participating, and thank you for contributing. You will see me soon.